And good afternoon to you. It's Monday the 13th of February 2017. A warm welcome along to this afternoon here on United Kingdom Talk, boys and girls. I'm a little bit late today. I've been out this morning swimming. I came back. And I think this is only the second or third time I've done this. So I thought, well, I want to do a show today. I'll have a quick meal. And rather than put it in the oven, I got out from my fridge one of those ready-made cottage pie things, a soya cottage pie that I got the other day from Tesco's. We had a little trip to Tesco's. So I put it in the microwave, holes in the top and all that business, put it on 6 minutes. Now, I don't know about you, but I do quite like to multitask, do many things at the same time. So while that was in there, I got the washing out of the machine. I've put that outside. I thought, because it's quite windy outside today, the sun is shining, but don't be fooled by that. That sun shining, because I did that this morning and I went out with my very less hair. OK, and I went out walking up to the swimming pool. I thought, oh, it'd be nice today. The sun shines out. Oh, dear. It's bleeding cold. Very cold out there. So if you're going out later, you'll need a hat if you're in the same sort of state as me. And two coats. Well, you know, something underneath and something on top, because it is quite cold out there. Hung the washing up, and as I came in, the cat's moaning. It's meow, meow, meow. And then she goes and stands next to her food thing, which is empty. So I fed her. Then the machine went bing, and I went over to it, and I thought, well, I just put my vegetables in there. And as I've taken it out, I've put it on the side. Okay, put it on the side next to the thing. You already know where this is going, don't you? I can tell. You already know where this is going. Put the vegetables in again. Couple of bowls in the top. I'm a bit lazy with vegetables. I get those little packets of things or like plastic tub type things. Couple of bowls in the top. Shove them in the microwave. 4 minutes done. And they come out so lovely. Bit of butter on the top as well. They usually shove in there. So I've done that. I've taken those out. And then I've picked up the cottage pie. As I've taken the lid off, I've tipped it upside down. It's gone all over the floor. Oh, horrendous. Not only did it go all over the floor, but I've got like these gates in front of the windows or behind the windows, like security type things, right, which have always been in. And it's gone in there and it's gone up these and in like the little bit where there's a slot along the floor that the door travels in and it's gone under there. Oh, Lord. I mean, I'll be honest with it. It was easier cleaning up the cat's dirt when she goes on the floor. Although she has now started going on the newspaper. It's not she's a lot better now. I think she's got better over the last few days because the cat hasn't been too right recently. She does walk around in circles quite a lot. So that's and then I had my dinner. So I shoved another one in there and I was going to throw the whole thing away. But I scraped out what was left in the bowl. You know, I didn't scrape off the floor and eat that. Christ, I'm not that bad. I mean, a bread roll or something like that, I probably would. Do you ever do that? You know, you drop something on the floor and I pretend this is a bread roll. Okay, so you drop Do you do that as well? Come on, don't lie to me. Oh, no, not if you're in front of people. Of course not if you're in front of people. But when you're own, I bet you drop things on the floor and still eat them, don't you? But I wasn't going to sort of sit on the floor with a knife and fork and start eating my Sainsbury's vegetarian cottage pie. No, so I shoved another one in there and I used what was out and that was it. By the time I put it all on the plate, actually, it was quite a lot. Looked like two meals, to be honest. It really did. So I sat downstairs, watched a little bit of Tabboo. I'm nearly at the end of Saturday's programme. And excellent. So very, very rude, dear. Oh, there was sex in it as well. Naked bodies. Oh, that man who plays the lead role is very, very good looking, isn't he? Tattoos all up his back and everything. We like a bit of that. Oh, yes. And I had my dinner and then I've come up here and here we are chatting away to you. So good afternoon to you, boys and girls. Let's say hello to the early people who are with us today. Who's logging on first today? Danny Davies is with us from Welsh Wales. Hello, Danny Davies. Manager of Greg's the Bakers in Wrexham. Adam's there, Adam the plumber. We've got Tim, who says it's nice time for a phone-in. Yes, we'll probably get a call or two later. I shall be opening the lines shortly, boys and girls. But I'm going to give you something to talk about as well today, OK? Hello to Elaine in Israel. Nice to see you leave your palatial manor to be with us. Yes, you may have seen a picture on the top of my Facebook profile there. Most of you know, I'm a bit of a landlord. Okay, and one of my properties has recently come available. The old tenants have moved out. The Duke and Duchess of Cambridgeshire. And it is now available for rent. Okay, if you want to have a little look at that, go to the top of my Facebook timeline. Have a look on my timeline. Should be just below this. There's a picture of one of my properties that's available to rent at the moment. Okay, my loves? Obviously, I cannot discuss prices and things like that. That would just be vulgar, wouldn't it? We can't discuss prices and things on here, but if you private message me, I'll give you a full list of the various prices that are available for the said property. Hello to Dino's with us this afternoon. Hello, Dino. Lovely Sharon Stone. All right, Sharon, when are you coming back to Central Station, darling? Karaoke tonight. Central Station, Wharfdale Road, King's Cross, every Monday, 8 till 11.30 with cheap drinks. Oh, yeah. Sharon loves the old cheap drinks. Yeah, Sharon. Yeah, yeah, have a drink. Have a drink, Chris. Have a drink. So Sharon's with her. Hello, Sharon. Hello to Carl Rex Mawson. Hello, Carl. Are you not at work today? Very unusual for you not to be at work. Tim says, 3 deaths in one day. Fortunately, not mine. As you can see, I'm not dead yet, although I had trouble sleeping again last night. Funny, another night off, another night trouble sleeping. And it wasn't anything to do with anything I ate, because I made sure I ate about 9 o'clock. So 9, 10, 11, 12. But about 12 o'clock, I came up here and started doing things. You know, with the live streaming equipment, I've managed to achieve a few things last night with the help of Adam the plumber, who I was having a little private. I was streaming stuff privately with him. I found a way to do that now, and we've managed to achieve a couple of things which you will see during this show. It's all very exciting. I mean, the TV people have been doing it for years, but I've just worked out how to do it. How, you're wondering what it is now? All will be revealed. All will be revealed. I will be naked in... No, perhaps not. No. Yes, Tim says, 3 deaths today. Al Jarreau. Now, he's a great soul singer. My favourite song by Al Jarreau was Love Is Waiting. Do you know that one? Love is waiting just around the bend, waiting for you to turn around. Oh, waiting, and it will never end. It's called Love Is Waiting. Have a look it up later on. Not now, dear. Not now. Look it up. Love Is Waiting from Al Jarreau. So he's died today. Damien from the Time Warp, who I worked with a couple of times at the Black Cap. Nice bloke he was. He's died today. And Caroline Sterling from the Archers. Which my mum used to listen to all the time. They've got quite a high listenership, haven't they, the Archers? Eh? The tale of little country folk in somewhere of. I've never really listened to it. But this lady was in the Archers. So 3 today. It's just getting more and more, dear. Soon I'll be the only one here. Maybe I should have my own satellite channel. What do you think of that? You know, constant. I could be on 24 hours a day. All the programmes would just be me. But they would be different. We wouldn't do the same programmes all the time. You know, for example, the 9 o'clock news from United Kingdom Talk with Chris Reardon. And that would be followed by Chris Reardon's Generation Game. And that would be followed by, you know, a documentary about geese at the Antarctic with Chris Reardon. Things like that. What do you think? Call My Bluff with Chris Reardon. And is it a call or is it bluff? Well, it is a bluff. Is that still on? Call My Bluff. I went to see that at the BBC when it was recorded. I mean, going back in 30 years. My dad took me. We went to see Call My Bluff and it was very exciting going to the BBC Television Centre in Wood Lane, which has gone now, hasn't it? I think there's a few little bits there, but the majority of it's gone. You can buy a flat there now. Yep, £500,000. How many do you want? 2? 3? Any offers? Any more on 3? You can actually buy a flat there. They've turned it into flats. And we went to the BBC and I was amazed. Amazed. All these cameras there, and great big things they were then. They were, I think they were called Marconi cameras. And there would be a bloke standing and pushing them around. I think there were three altogether. And the people came in and they recorded one show. Oh, they're going to record it. And anyway, so they record six shows. Well, we didn't know this. And let me tell you, by the sixth one, we were bloody well bored. We were so bored after the sixth show. Couldn't wait to get out. And you can't leave. I don't know if they had a toilet. I suppose they must have had a toilet there, do they? I didn't use it. I think I held it. Cool, we were glad to get out of there. It was so hot as well. By the sixth show, you were sweating like anything. But all the people that were on the show, you know, the contestants, they all go and change clothes. So that when you see it on the telly, you think it's a new show, like one a day. But it's not. They do six at a time. Very, very busy. Very busy. So that was a nice thing to see there. Elaine says, I worked with Al Jarreau when he was here on tour. A lovely man and a great artist. Yeah, great soul artist, Elaine. Really, really very good. Tim says, Radio 2 letting all their regular daytime presenters be on holiday at the same time. Oh, is that right? You've got Fern Cotton, Vanessa Feltz and Sarah Cox on there today. Oh, not Sarah Cox, dear. Is that the Ladette? Sarah Cox, the Ladette. I didn't like her on Radio 1 at all. I think Radio 2 are proving that they are female friendly following the acts. Oh, is Janice Long gone? Not Janice Long. We love Janice Long. Has she gone? She did some of the overnight stuff occasionally, or late night stuff, didn't she? Oh, dear. Good afternoon to Alan. Alan's coming along to the karaoke tonight. Hello to Jerry. Jerry's received his mug in the post. Just to let you know, all the mugs have now gone out, OK? There's none left. There's none left. All the United Kingdom Talk mugs have now gone out. And they should be with you forthwith. If you're in the States and there's one coming over to you there, they go by land, not air. They go by land. So that can take 3 or 4 weeks. But if you're in the UK, you should have your mug by the end of the week. If it doesn't arrive, please let me know. If you've asked for one and it does, if you're in the UK, right, and you've asked for a mug and it doesn't arrive by Friday, please let me know. OK, if you're in America, give it until mid-March. If you haven't got it by then, let me know and we'll see if we can do something about that. But at the moment, all the mugs have gone, so there's none left. If you're wondering what we're talking about mugs, a little while ago, I was giving away mugs. United Kingdom Talk mugs. Yes, with the logo and a little picture of me on the side there. But they were only for, really, our totally regular viewers that watch every single show. And I advertise them. If you want one, just send us in an email on that. And people did. And so they're all gone now. All right, my darling. Hello to, excuse me. Good morning to Tweety Charlotte, who says, good morning from the US. Good morning, Tweety. It's a while since I saw your lovely little face, darling. Pray for us. Pray for everyone, darling. I went to a new church, actually, Tweety, on Sunday. That was quite nice. The Sacred Heart in Sunningdale. Look it up. Beautiful church. Really nice. And I quite like it. It kind of, and the altar is like up. You know, it's almost like, I can't explain it. It's actually much higher than most of the ones that I've seen. The only thing is with the priest was a bit quiet and I couldn't hear him. But the sermon was only about 6 minutes long, so I was quite happy about that. Because your bum starts aching, doesn't it, Tweety? You know when you're sitting on those hard wooden chairs, your bum does start aching. Hello to Tim. Nothing beats a rice time from Uncle Ben. 90 seconds in the microwave. Low-fat korma. Oh, I quite like Uncle Ben's. I like Uncle Ben's. They do a Mediterranean wholemeal rice vegetable with vegetables in it. That's quite, it's quite spicy. Very, very nice. And wholemeal rice is supposed to be very good for you. Did you know that? That's true. Elaine wants to know what's happened to the lovely plant. That's been moved now to somewhere else, Elaine. OK, I do like to have a little bit of a change around on here. I've got two lovely orchids here. One's from Maureen and one's from Kym, who comes to sing at a karaoke. He's really good singer, Kym, an all-round nice guy. So he'll probably turn up tonight, I hope. Hello to Gustav. Has he tweedled? No. Thank you, Gustav. Button push. Or I will eventually remember that. Maybe I should put a sign up in front of me, you know, push your buttons now. Sound like Marty Kane now from New Faces, don't I? Tim says, can't wait to catch up with Tabboo. Tabboo is excellent. It's an excellent programme on BBC One Saturday nights at 9 o'clock. At 10 o'clock, I think, after Casualty. It's really good. If you haven't seen any of it yet, catch it on the iPlayer. Very, very good. Another programme I've started to watch now, they have remade Roots. Now, do you remember that, Roots? It's, I don't know why, but the BBC have shoved it on to BBC Four. Which is a bit odd to me, because when you watch it, you can see it's cost a lot of money to make this. And it's about the English buying slaves from Africa, which happened years and years. I don't know how long ago. Is it in the 1700s, maybe? Maybe someone could correct me on that. The 1700s. And it shows what they did. And it's just awful. Just awful. And they get all these people from Africa and they drag them. They're all chained up and they're chained downstairs on the boat so that they can't move around. Oh, it's horrific. Absolutely horrific what the English used to do to the Africans. I mean, I'm sure they weren't the only ones, you know, but I think it was 1700s, maybe earlier than that. So that's an excellent programme to watch. It can be quite upsetting, I warn you that, OK? But it's good to know history of all sorts. And it's on BBC Four. I'm not sure exactly when it's on, but the first episode was 90 minutes long. And watch it on the iPlayer. I'm watching it on the iPlayer, all right? Hello to John C. today. Hello, John Coops. He's with us. Tim says the Grammys are on tonight at 4 Music. So he's staying in. Oh, I can't think of anything more worse than watching those awards programmes. Can I just blow my nose? I really detest awards programmes and cookery programmes. Two really awful men. And all it is, they come on, they slap each other as bad. And it's all started getting rather political as well, hasn't it, now? I've noticed that. They're all making political statements either one way or the other. And I think that's wrong. Why would you want to sit there and watch someone go up and collect a cup? What the hell is all that about? Where is the entertainment value in that? I mean, it's all right when that funny bloke's on, that James Corden, isn't it? James Corden. Now, I like him because he makes me laugh, but I can't bear it. You know, how many times do you want to see Justin Bieber go up and, well, I mean, as many times as possible, if you ask me. All those muscles did. Isn't it funny how he turned himself around, Justin Bieber? Yeah, top marks, top credit to that boy. Yeah. So, no, I won't be watching that, Tim, or recording it, I'm afraid. Hello to Duke's with us this afternoon. Hello, Duke. Are you popping along tonight? It's about time you come and sang us a song or two, dear. Sharon Stone says, last time I was at Central Station, I fell in front of a parked bus. I was in a bad state. Sharon. Do you know how much I love you, Sharon? And I mentioned you to David Rosen the other day, and he remembers you straight away. I said, you never guess who kept... This is when you came into the Golden Line of... about a year or so ago. I said, you'd never guess who walked into the Gold Line. He said, who? I said, Sharon. He said, you mean Good Time Sharon? I said, yeah, Sharon came in. We love you, Sharon. You're very, very popular, darling, all right? Let's have a look. Let's just move up a little bit. Aha. Tim says, Call My Bluff was last on air in 2011, hosted by Angus Dayton. Now, no. Who was the host? Oh. The host, when I saw it, Robinson. Something Robinson. Robert Robinson. He was the host when I watched it. And it had James Muir on it, you know, with a big moustache. And the other chap who had a really bad stutter. I can't remember what his name, but it was great. That's how I remember Call My Bluff. So that is really some time ago. It was last on air in 2011, Tim says, hosted by Angus Dayton, Poser. Which of these presenters has never hosted Call My Bluff? A, Fiona Bruce. B, Bob Holness. Or C, Robert Robinson? Fiona Bruce, I reckon. Fiona Bruce. The answer, trick question, they have all hosted it at some time or another. Oh, we don't... Trick question, dear! Trick question, how outrageous you are! Dear, dear me. Thank you to Tim. I think he's put the information of the church I went to on Sunday up there for you. Danny Davis, can we call now? Well, not yet, really, Danny. I haven't opened the lines yet, dear. It's just a little story I want to tell before we open the lines. What have you got? What have I given you to call about so far? Nothing. I haven't given you anything to call about so far yet, have I? God's sake, man. What are you on, dear? So here we are. Here's a story for you. Now, here we are. Another story about trashy people, boys and girls. Here we go. Look at this. Look at this. A moment, a shocking mass brawl broke out between more than 100 people at a... What sort of pub? Go on, have a guess. Go on, have a guess. Have a wild stab in the dark. A Weatherstones pub. Yes, boys and girls. Dozens of men were filmed beating each other. Well, some of them looked like they could have beached up on a beach somewhere, I must say. My God, look at the size of those stomachs. Mind you, I can't talk. I just tried to put a Fred Perry extra large shirt on. It won't do up around my stomach. That's terrible, isn't it? It will not do up round my stomach. It's disgusting. It really is. Now, this is a large, and yet it does up. So it must be the cut. It must be the cut, mustn't it? Anyway, dozens of men were filmed up, beating each other up at the Old Albany Palace in Trowbridge, Wiltshire. On Saturday night, as music played in the background, a police officer was allegedly struck in the face but avoided serious injury, while one person since has been charged with the possession of a knife. Oh, my God. Weatherstones management said the company completely condemns the fight, added that it caused distress to our staff and regular customers. I should think it does. But, you know, when you go past... I'm sorry, I have to say it. When you go past these Weatherstones pubs and you look in there, you just know that trouble... It looks to me like trouble could kick off at any point indeed, don't you think? Do you ever look at the Weatherstones pub?
I have to say it. When you go past these Weatherstones...
Just a minute. Shut up. I don't know why that's come up there. 1 minute. I've got to do something now, otherwise I'll lose my messages. 1 minute. There it is. Is that right there? That's it. There we are. That's it. That's it there. Sometimes when you go past these pubs, I mean, they just look like they're trouble. Doesn't happen in any of the places I go to. Certainly not the King's Head Theatre Bar where we do the quiz on Wednesday. Or Central Station. We have door staff there usually. Door staff, dear. Nothing happens there. God's sake. And I was wondering. I'm wondering today. Have you ever been in a pub where a mass brawl has taken out? Has taken place? Have you ever seen that? Maybe not everyone in a pub, but a good fair quantity of them. If so, I'd like you to tell me about this afternoon. Now, watch this. If you're watching the live show, are you ready? Watch this. Watch this. Whoa! A number has appeared. A phone number. Oh, actually, it's a bit too high, isn't it? 1 minute. Let's move that down a bit. I've got to move that down a bit because otherwise you won't see it. Let's just... there we are. Now, is that number big enough? Can you see it enough? There we are. Done it. I had to remember to move that down. I'm going to have to move that over a bit now because you can't see it. Just a minute, dear. Let's have a little bit of a move around while we're here. There we are. That's it. All right. How's that? Is that better? That'll do, won't it? There we are. A number has now appeared on your television screens if you're watching a live show. If you're watching a recording, you can't call in because no one will answer it. But a number has now appeared. Have you ever observed or indeed been involved in a brawl in a pub? Then call in and let me know this afternoon. The number has appeared up there. It's 020-8144-3477. 020-8144-3477. There's some other stuff that I learnt while I was up late last night, mucking around with this live streaming and all that business, which you will see should I get a caller in or two. Okay? 020-8144-3477. I also have a Skype in. If you've got Skype, you can call in. The Skype in is all one word, United Kingdom Talk. The Skype in, all one word, United Kingdom Talk. So let's go to the phone now. Call already from Danny Davies in Wrexham in North Wales. Hello, Danny.
Good afternoon.
A very good afternoon to you. And I am very unanimous in that. Oh, have you got me switched on somewhere, dear?
No, I haven't got you switched on. I think my phone, the volume is a little bit high. There we go.
Okay, now, I haven't got you logged in here. Just a moment, please. I'm going to have to do something now. Don't worry, everyone. I know I've disappeared for a minute. But if I can just... Because I've been very, very clever, Danny. Danny D. Can I title you as Danny D?
Yes, of course right. You can.
Now, I only have to do this once and then you're in the system, so to speak. So for the moment, that'll do that one there. Can you see your screen or not?
No, because I'm using Skype so and use my phone, so I can't see anything.
Right, hang on a minute. Let's, so once I've got you in, I don't have to do all this. Order. Where's order? Just a minute. Transfer. Fit to screen. There you are. Fit to screen. And that's it. Lovely. Let's do that again. Okay, so let's go to Danny Davis on the phone. Greetings, Danny.
Good afternoon.
So you don't know what I've done now, do you?
No.
There's now a picture of you up, and you're holding a, looks like a cup of fizzy orange in a Pepsi glass.
It's, what, the, what, is it off my Facebook, is it?
Yes, dear.
It's my dog.
Well, it don't look like a dog to me. It looks like a glass of war of orange to me, Danny.
Oh, does it? Oh,
no, well, I can't. Not a glass, a cup of orange. It's all very technical and clever here now, you know.
Oh, I'll have
even,
a look later.
I can even, do you know, I think I can even display you while I'm, let's try this now. Add existing, let's try to see if that works. Oh, yes, I can even display you next to me. How fabulous is that? This is only if you're watching live. If you're watching a recording, you can't see any of that. How exciting is that, Danny?
It sounds all very exciting.
It is. Now, tell us, have you ever experienced a mass brawl or a bit of a fight in a pub, Danny? Tell us the excitement, dear.
Well, I wasn't involved personally because I was working.
We
had a funeral in the pub that I'm temporarily working in.
Yes.
And they'd been drinking since 11 a.m.
Right.
Now, this happened about 7 o'clock in the evening. So me and my manager literally had to throw everyone out, and I nearly got punched, but I ducked, and my manager got punched in their face.
Did you duck? Did you duck?
I ducked very quickly, yes.
And what was it over?
It was, they just had too much to drink.
Really?
It was just...
Yeah, but there's always something that sets it off. It's usually... Number one, a girl. They fight over a girl. Or number two, right, someone's picked up someone else's drink.
I think it was just that someone had said something and they didn't like it, because I heard, don't speak to me like that and all this.
Oh, dear, dear me. And were they, so, they're all grown, weren't they? All grown people, were they?
All grown, yeah, all grown men and women. And I literally... They literally took them outside and said, you're not coming in until you've sobered up.
Oh, that's very hard of you. I'm getting scared now listening to your voice, Danny, to be honest.
So literally, I said to one of the girls, can you just help me clear the table? So I literally got every single drink on that table, whether they were part of that group or not, and took them away. And they came and said to me, well, I've paid for that drink. Well, I said, no, you're not, because you're not having any more to drink unless you go and walk away for an hour, calm down, get some food. Or the only thing I'll be serving you is water. A good H2O.
Well, that's fair talk, isn't it? You see, I don't think I couldn't do that. I chuck people out of a pubs and they just lie, don't they lie? They lie, yeah, and they lie and they lie. No, it wasn't me. It's like when I catch someone cheating at a quiz. You know, they will stand there until they're blue in the face. You know, lying that they didn't cheat. I call it the godless society, of course. When I was a child, you didn't dare lie because you would have thought what's going on there? Oh, you would have thought that a thunderbolt would come down from heaven and strike you dead.
Yes, that's the way. That's,
no one's scared of it anymore, dear. But fortunately, Danny, you are there to scare them instead.
Yes, my big butchness. Well, I wouldn't go that far. But anyway, yes, I've received my mug and it's used every single day.
Good, it didn't break them. We've had one or two of them break in the post, unfortunately, which I mentioned to my sister and she said that happens all the time. You just have to, you know, you just have to put up with it. The only thing is one of those that went to the States got broken as well. So that's quite a little bit of an issue sending stuff there. But this time I've put it in like one of those bubble bag things, the ones to America. Because it don't matter. You know, I don't think it makes any difference the amount of... I've got my fragile tape with me. And you wrap everything in that, makes no difference at all. They still chuck it in the bag, don't they?
Yeah. Well, the Royal Mail in Wales is very good. It didn't come broken.
Good.
It arrived, and then the first thing I did was pop the kettle on.
Did you? So you immediately had your lips around my little face, didn't you?
Yes.
How lovely. Look, and my special fragile tape. Fragile tape that I'm showing to people. Have you started it? You haven't started at Greg's yet still, have you?
No, it's next 3 weeks I'll be starting. They've actually... Oh, that's my... Sorry.
Oh, dear. That... Have you plugged something in?
No, it's my phone telling me I've got a message.
Oh, Danny. Oh, I think I'd better let you go now. You're obviously getting ready to do something there.
Oh, it's fine. What was that? We were talking about Greg's, weren't we? Yes, 3 weeks. I've had the start date.
Yeah.
So 3 weeks we'll be starting, and then the store opens the following week.
Lovely.
So very happy about that.
Looking forward to that. I did pop into Greg's on Friday. I had a nice cheese and onion pasty and a delicious vegetable pasty. They do nice pasties in there. But I do find that the pizza slices, by the time you get them, they're usually stone cold, the pizza slices. I guess
I'm a big fan of pizza.
I guess they just don't hold the heat as long as the other things do, though. They're constantly cooking things in there, aren't they? Always doing that sort of stuff.
Yeah. Sandwiches that's made on site as well. And
yeah, lovely.
Everything that you see is cooked on site made on site.
We like Greg's the Bakers very much. All right, Danny, have a lovely afternoon.
And you take care, and I'll
speak
to you soon.
Thank you for calling in. Bye-bye, Danny.
Goodbye.
Cheerio. Danny Davies calling in there for you, boys and girls. Anyone else want to chat today about whether or not you experienced a fight in a pub? I have. The worst one I ever had was in around 1983, I think, and I was doing a soul night at a place in Putney called The Telegraph. And it was a nice pub, actually. This place in Putney was The Telegraph pub, and I was doing a soul night there, all 80s soul, around about 1983. And it had been going for a few weeks, and I'd got very busy. I think it was on a Thursday night. It was really busy in there as well. And then one day, suddenly, a glass flew over. I watched this glass fly over. It was packed in here. Packed. This glass flew over everyone, and that was it. The entire place erupted. Glasses, tables and chairs were flying left, right and centre. And there's this... People from both sides come up to me and says, it's all right, mate, you'll be all right. Just get underneath the table. Your gear won't get damaged. Because, of course, it's nothing to do with me, you know. And by the time it had finished, oh, my God, the state of the place. Me? I'm still standing there. No one had touched anything of mine. But I wasn't asked back for some reason. It's like it was my fault. But, of course, it wasn't, you know. So that's the worst one I've ever experienced. Adam the Plumber is on the phone. Good afternoon, Adam the Plumber.
Good afternoon, Chris Frieden.
And how are you today, sir?
I'm very well, thank you. I'm just on a training course today.
Oh, are you? What are you learning? What are you learning today?
I'm learning what they call PTS, which is personal track safety.
Okay.
So, basically, what happens is every 2 years I have to reset this exam to make sure that I am competent and safe that I can go on the railway lines.
Is it one of those things, like, where you... you're sent on a... You do the job for so long and then you're sent on a course to do the job that you've already been doing for so many years.
That's it.
BT. Well, no,
you have to reset the course every 2 years.
Yeah. British Telecom used to be like that for us. We'd be doing the job for ages and then we'd be sent away on a course. Usually to somewhere like Milton Keynes. Not actually Milton Keynes, a bit closer than that. Bletchley. You know Bletchley?
I do. I know all of those stations up there. I used to work on the London Midland contract.
Oh, right. Well, Bletchley, they've got a music... That's where, of course, they did the Morse code and that. During the war, or one of the wars, or both of them. I'm not sure which. But they did Morse code and all that. And if you go there, I think it's open to the public. You can go around and see the Morse, the machines and all the codes and... when people did codes and all that. I'm sure there's a museum up there. Bletchley Park, it's called. That's it.
Right,
yes.
Yeah, I've heard of it.
Fights in pubs, Adam.
Fights in pubs. I used to own one in Brighton, a pub.
Oh, you run a pub yourself?
Yeah, I used to own a pub in Brighton.
You ran one or you owned one?
No, I owned one.
Oh, wow, I didn't know that.
Yeah, I actually owned a pub in Brighton.
I thought you just ran that.
No, I actually owned it.
What was it called?
It was called. It was originally called the Clyde. It was in a place called Whitehawk. And then a guy from London called Tony bought it and renamed it the Pink Panther. The most ridiculous name ever.
How did I go along with that? Yeah.
I mean, you can imagine, you know, a gay bar or a mixed bar in the middle of Whitehawk. For viewers that don't know, Whitehawk is an estate in Brighton, basically.
I think I know it. I'm sure my friend Jason used to live on there.
Uh-huh.
Did you have to go up like a really steep hill to get to it?
Yeah, that's it, yeah.
That's the one. Oh, awful place. Ghastly people there, dear. Little shoppers.
Slower than 6 miles an hour and they take your tyres off your car.
That's right, yeah. That'll be the one. What an awful place that is. Anyway, go on.
Yeah, so, oh, God, hold on a minute. My phone's playing. Sorry. Hold on.
Am I on in the background somewhere, dear?
Sorry, it just came.
How many places
are we
being played today?
I had paused you.
Have I been paused?
You have been paused from me. Anyway, anywho, so I own this pub in Brighton, and as I say, it was originally called the Pink Panther. So when I took it over, I took the licence on, bought it off this guy. The first thing I went to the judge and said I'd like to go for a change of name of the pub. And he said, what would you like to call it? I said, I'd like to call it the Broadway Bar, because it was just up the road from the shops that were called the Broadway, and it was also sort of show tunes and things like that that we put on there, and we've got cabaret acts on, so it's sort of Broadway, as it were. The judge said, yes, we'll allow that. He said, and the old owner standing there said, who on earth invented the name of the Pink Panther for the name of a pub is beyond me. And the old owner's face just dropped to the floor.
Yes, I should imagine would. Were you busy in there? Did you make a success of that, Adam?
I did, yeah. It was running very well. And then my business partner and partner of 3 years decided to disappear with the contents of the safe one day and completely ruin the business for me. So that was that was 15 grand taken out of the safe.
I think people don't realise, you know, a lot of the places, including yours, that you tick over week by week, and you just can't take one large loss like that.
No, it totally ruined me. You know, I had to, declare bankruptcy and everything, and that was the end of it. And that's what, you know, that's why I went back into doing the plumbing. That's what I'd learned as a trade. It's, you know, with my dad when I was 15, from the age of about 14 onwards, my dad taught me plumbing as a trade, and I just went back into that.
Right. So, what do you prefer?
To be honest with you, I prefer the work I'm doing now, working on the trains and working out on the stations and running my little business in the evenings and weekends. It suits me down to the ground. It's not, I don't have to worry about sort of worrying where the next sort of pennies are coming from, sort of thing, you know.
Yes, of course. Sort of thing. Yeah.
I mean, yes, I'm still self-employed, and, you know, and that's just extra pocket money.
So did you have any fights in there?
Yes, yeah, we did, yeah. There was one particular nasty one with a couple of lads. The pub had a reputation of two families that were at war since the 60s because it was an estate pub. And the thing was, you always let them sort it out between themselves. Well, this one just escalated and escalated and escalated. And in the pub, in the end, the whole pub just got totally destroyed.
Oh, my word.
So I got the two heads of the families together and said, you've got two choices. I either take this to the police and press charges, or you get your family down here within the next 48 hours and get my pub looking like a pub again. And credit to them, they got the pub looking like the pub again, bought new light fittings.
That's fair dues. That's fair dues. Yeah, absolutely fair dues.
They bought new light fittings, new mirrors and things like that, put the pub back to normal. And the two lads that were involved, I got them to come down and have a meeting with each other and get them to iron their differences out with their family there as well. And it all got resolved and everything got put back to normal.
Blessed are the peacemakers, lovey. Blessed are the peacemakers. I think you've missed something here. You're very good at doing that.
I mean, I had the policy in the pub of never barring anybody unless it was a really naughty misdemeanor. If it was drunk and disorderly, I looked at it as my fault, or my fault, because the thing is with the licensing law, you're not meant to allow people to get beyond sort of capability of looking after themselves and getting themselves home.
Yeah.
You know, if anybody came down in a car, and I knew all my regulars, if anybody came down in a car and they ordered a drink, I'd say, well, you've got two choices. Can I have a soft drink? If you have an alcohol drink, pass me your keys over the bar. But I'm only having one. I said, no. In this pub, it's one drink. Keys come over the bar. It's up
very
to you.
Very good. Now, you were a very good landlord.
Yeah, I was very respectful of the law and of my customers, and it worked. Mm. You know, I turned the pub round from sort of ticking over. The last person that sort of owned it had a locked door policy. You sort of had to ring a little doorbell to get in. It's like a private members club.
Right.
We're going back to 1999, 2000, I took that over. So, you know, it was like a locked door policy. The prices were London prices, which didn't work. And it alienated the locals. So
yeah,
I got
course,
rid of all that.
Course.
I brought back, I put a pool table in and put a bar billiards table in, Sky Sports and a darts team. Had a cafe next door. Even opened on Christmas Day 1 year and had 100 people come for Christmas dinner.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah.
So you was you really were actually a community pub in the real sense of the word, weren't
yeah,
you?
Yeah, almost definitely, yeah. I knew all the customers, knew all their problems, knew all the families.
It's people like you that should be running pubs. And I suppose the money side of things you found secondary, did you really, to everything else?
I did, yeah.
The same as me, see, that's exactly the same as me. I do all these karaoke and this, that and the other. But honestly, the wages are secondary. To me, top thing in my mind, I want people to go home with a bit of a smile on their face and have a nice night. Not how much can I get out of you? You know,
no, exactly. I mean, one of the things that I did, we got when I took the license on, I went for special opening hours from 10:30 in the morning, because the licensing hours were 11 then, and I got the exemption for 10:30.
What did you do? And coffee mornings.
And the reason behind it was because the pension, the people that collected their pension who were on their own, wanted to come in the pub and have a socialised drink with their friends before the regular sort of came in. So I had it as, I didn't call it pension day, but it was more or less all the pensioners would come in early in the morning between sort of 10:30 and 11 before they went and done their shopping, it might be, before all the regular crowd came in, so they could have some time to themselves and chat to people of their own age and stuff.
And did you do was it like a coffee morning sort of thing?
Yeah, sort of thing. But, you know, alcohol was served. It was allowed to be served because I had the license from 10:30, but it was the only pub in the area that opened at the time, and it was very busy and very popular.
A proper community pub. That's what I like, Adam.
Yeah, that's where
and
I had it.
You obviously got on well with the judge that that gives you all the licenses and all that, didn't
you? Yeah, I mean, I had a very good reputation with the police and because the pub, historically, even if you look it up on the internet today, the pub historically had terrible history, a really terrible
history.
What
was it called again?
It was originally called the Clyde.
The Clyde
in Bristol Gardens in Whitehawk. And then it became the Pink Panther, and then it became the Broadway Bar.
Right.
But historically, it had you know, because it was a locals pub and it was an estate pub, it was sort of it tried to be run by the local. And I had some very sort of, you know, some very easy laid down laws. It's like when I first took it over, you know, if the bar phone would ring and it was a pay phone as well as having a phone behind the bar, it was on the same line. Customers would always pick it up. So I put up this notice: anybody wishing to answer the telephone, you know, please do so, but please be aware you'll have to take on the telephone bill and the bills of running the pub.
Yeah.
If you want to be involved in running my bar, and it stopped me getting nobody.
Oh, I agree. I agree.
Nobody
dare
answer.
Yeah.
Nobody dare answer. But it was done in a jovial way. It's like, okay, you want to answer the phone? You know, can you come in tomorrow morning at 6:30 to see the beer order in, please? Before you clean the pub, before you open it.
I worked in a place in Battersea. It was one of my first places that I DJ'd in, called The Stag, run by a lovely lady called Pam Reynolds. That would be 1986, 85, 84, somewhere around there. And that was nice. She's no longer with us, sadly. I kind of kept her in very loose touch with, you know, maybe a phone call every couple of years. And then 1 year, I couldn't get an answer, and I looked her up, and she died. She became a mayor of somewhere as well for a while, down in, I think, down Cornwall way, somewhere like that. And anyway, she was telling me when she went to take over, she was very successful in Battersea. And then she sold the pub and went to this place somewhere near Brighton, the Beech Tree, maybe. And again, it was in the middle of a housing estate, the Beech Tree, I think it was called. Yep. And it didn't work for her there. And I left the Stag to go and work with her down there, but it just didn't work. It just didn't work.
No.
And she was telling me, well, when she went to the judge, that pub also, it wasn't always called the Beech Tree, that pub as well had a very bad reputation. And she was going in there, taking it over. And the judge says to her, he says, can I ask you, what is your, I remember her telling me this, what is your thoughts on anyone who's a bit underage? Maybe they look underage, but you know, that, what do you think about that? Well, my motto of that, Your Honour, is if in doubt, chuck them out. I don't have any bother like that. I don't put up with anything like that. Oh, right. Okay. Very good. Very good. He said, right, and after she said that, he said, right, you've requested to have a fruit machine. Is that right, Mrs. Reynolds? She said, yes, that's right. If at all possible, could we have a fruit machine? He said, yes, of course. Is one enough? Do you want any more than that? Mm-hmm. So, and at that point, she knew he was on her side after that because she was very strong. And I think you have to be a very, very, very strong character and thick-skinned to run a pub. Mm-hmm. I mean,
yeah,
really, you know,
I've
been in pubs working before and I've been sitting next to a manager or something like that, and they've been taking a lot of abuse from someone who's 9 times out of 10 they're drunk, you know, mm-hmm. and then the next day they ring up and apologise and that's all right, you know, whatever. But
yeah, that's it.
Yeah,
but you know, I had quite good training. I used to, before, as you remember, I worked in the Cap and I worked in Bell and King's Cross.
Yes,
and they were owned by Bass. Right. Bass Charrington, who are no longer with us, I don't think, Bass now.
No, Messrs and Butlers now.
It's all been split into little groups of pubs. But when Bass, and they were real training houses, and they, you know, sort of, yeah,
yes, of course, of course.
Sellermanship to sort of how to end an evening. And there's still so many pubs that get it so wrong at the end of the evening.
I agree.
They flick the lights up full blast. And say, come on, we've had your money.
Piss off.
Yep. That's it.
All right, Adam, so, nice to talk to you today, sir.
And you, and I must say, I do like the new graphics. They're very good. You must have worked hard on that all night.
We worked hard on this all night, these little graphics things and bits and pieces. What I'll have to do, though, is set up camera and picture. It don't look very good when I'm sort of adjusting the picture, so we'll have to do that for all the regular callers. And and as new one comes in, I'll add them. I've got pictures of four people, actually. I've got you, Ray Reynolds, Keith George, Danny Davis, and Elaine. I've got a picture of you, Elaine, as well. If it's okay, I should ask people actually if they want me to. Oh, you know, I've just realised the phone number is hidden, isn't it, under the live message? The phone number is actually hidden under the live message.
Yep.
Oh, right. So I've got to drop that down a bit more, haven't I? Let's have a look.
It's my pussy hiding, is it?
Eh?
It's my pussy hiding.
Your pussy is hiding. Yes. Hang on. Let's just drop that down a bit because I didn't realise that. No one told me that. You would have thought someone had noticed that, wouldn't you? There
well,
we
you
I'll
see,
move that
it's
down.
because you're speaking to your technical advisor on the phone.
Technical advisor. Let's try and
to
do
UK
that.
TV,
and that would be better than that. There you are. I think you're fine. I've done that. You can have a look now, Adam, and just drop us a little message saying it looks all right
now.
I'll go back
online and carry on watching the show.
Okay.
Lovely speaking to you, Chris, and I hope to see you possibly tonight if I can get down there.
All right, Adam. Cheerio now.
Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, love. Adam the plumber calling in there, boys and girls. If you want any plumbing work done, that is the man to go with, OK? A couple of other messages this afternoon, and then we'll do today's birthdays. Good afternoon to Mark Cording. Good afternoon, Mark. You pumping down for a sing-song tonight? I do hope so. Vectis is watching us today while on the toilet. How awful. How awful. Please don't watch us on the toilet. I do object to people watching us on the toilet, all right? So there we are. Today's birthdays then, boys and girls. Let's do today's birthdays. And then we're going to finish up today. I shall have a little sleep before I go and do tonight's karaoke. Happy birthday to karaoke singer and person who works, I think he works at Sky now. He used to work at CNN. CNN International. He used to work there, but he works at Sky now. Happy birthday to Stephen Howe, who's 34 years old today. Happy birthday, Stephen. Oh, hang on, we've just got to take the number off there. That's it. There we are. Happy birthday today to the lovely Sarah Christian. Sarah lives on one of the most beautiful places in the world, Norfolk Island, which I had the privilege of visiting twice, actually a number of years ago. It's really a beautiful place, Norfolk Island, in the South Pacific between Sydney and Australia and New Zealand. Norfolk Island, try and visit that sometime. Happy birthday, Sarah, and lots of love to all your family. I guess they're all grown up now, aren't they? I met all of them. They all came round. And we had a dinner together, a few dinners together, didn't we? Happy birthday, Sarah. Happy birthday today to Emma Byrne. Happy birthday, Emma. Kurt Hoffman. To Dana Arrington, 37 today. To Kym Marley, 49 today. You're not quite up with me yet, Kim. 49's a good age, darling. And to the lovely Gail Murphy. Gail, I went on holiday with her years and years ago. It was for one of my good friend's wedding. And he married a lovely girl who unfortunately died a little while ago now of breast cancer. But Gal was there as well. And I always remember you, Gal, darling. All right, so happy birthday to you all. Let's sing song. Here we go. Happy birthday, happy birthday to you. All right? Have a lovely, lovely birthday, darlings. All right? Enjoy your birthday. It's Monday night tonight, so I'll be hosting karaoke at Central Station Bar. That's in Wharfdale Road, King's Cross. All right? Karaoke tonight at Central Station Bar in Wharfdale Road, King's Cross. That's every Monday night between 8 p.m. and 11:30 p.m. And it's cheap drinks as well this evening as well. OK, if you're wondering what cheap drinks are, then I'll shortly put those up just before just after I finish on my Facebook wall. If you're not on my Facebook, then you can join me on there. It's facebook.com/ChrisReardonUK. You don't necessarily have to become a friend. You can just click a follow as well there if you want to for all the latest. Apart from that, enjoy the rest of your Monday afternoon. Thanks for watching and listening, and I'll see you soon. Cheerio now.